firstly, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land in which we gather here this evening, the Wurundjeri people, and pay my respects to elders both past and present. Membership is as listed in the agenda. Councillor Lawrence is on a leave of absence and has an apology this evening. Disclosures of conflicts of interest. Are there any disclosures? I'd like to start by making a disclosure to item 6.2, the Darabin Kindergarten Centralised Waiting List. I have an indirect interest in this matter. That is the kind of indirect interest as an interested party, as my son is an active currently on the waiting list.
Mayor, I'd also like to make the same declaration of an indirect interest in item 6.2 as my son is on the current waiting list, and so at the moment it is an indirect interest.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Are there any other disclosures? Thank you. Item 4 is a confirmation of the minutes of council meetings from the council meeting on the 19th of June and the special council meeting on the 22nd of June. Thank you, Councillor Messina. Move and a seconder. Thank you, Councillor Amir. All those in favour? Carried. Item 5, question and submission time. I have a number of questions that we have received online, so we'll go through those first. Question 1 is from Bridget Absalom Wong from Reservoir. Are you here this evening? No? I'll read out the question then. It would be a wonderful public service if a rubbish bin was placed here at the Fox Street playground. It is used a lot by the community. Wondering why there isn't one already. Also wondering why Wood Street Park isn't looked after more. It's my understanding that we pay a fee on our water bills for grass to be watered every summer. It is dry and dead, looking not in good condition at all. In comparison, All Nations Park seems to be lush and looked after well. Is this because more money is spent in Northcote? Wood Street is the only large playground in walking distance to my house. It would be lovely to be proud of it. And the response is that the Fulk Reserve is a small park, and generally pocket parks do not have bins installed unless a significant litter issue exists. Council has not received any complaints of litter issues with respect to this reserve. However, staff will continue to monitor the situation and take further action if required. We do not water parks and reserves with the exception of sporting ovals to maintain a safe playing surface. Darabin, like all councils, would like to water all of our parks and gardens. However, both the cost and the environmental impact of doing so is prohibitive. All Nations Park is an exception. The park was established over a large landfill, which has been capped with several metres of clay and soil to prevent pollution from escaping. The EPA requires us to keep the soil at a particular moisture level to maintain its integrity. The next two questions are from Brian Sunnigan. Would you like to read out your question? I'd just like to remind you that if you would like to participate in this meeting, that you need to be respectful of everyone that's here.
I think that's very respectful. I call my nieces princess.
That is not respectful, and if you'd
like to move that Mr. Sanigan be asked to leave, which I second the motion.
Sorry, Councillor. There is provision.
Can I read the question, please?
No, Mayor, I just would like to say one thing. There is provision.
Two, testing.
There is. Sorry, can you.
Do I have the floor?
No, you don't.
You just gave it to me.
And then I said I'd like to say something before you begin. There is provision in the local law to ask you to leave, and if you do interject or be offensive, I will ask you to leave. So if you could read your question, and I will provide a response.
Do I have the floor?
Yes.
Okay. Now that we're in the new financial year, can you tell me, Councillor, will the auditor of Council, Darabin City Council, for last financial year, be submitted to the Australian Tax Office contain the exact dollar amount that Council has paid to the MAB for the MAB's legal costs in Darabin Council and Coral Ross versus the MAB? What were the MAB's exact legal costs?
The amount Council paid to the MAB will be included in the audited financial statements that will feature in our 2016-17 annual report, but is not as separated as a line item. That level of detail is neither required nor practical for reporting and auditing purposes. Council is unaware of the exact amount the MAV's total legal costs in the matter of Darebin City Council on Coral Ross versus the Municipal Association of Victoria. However, Council paid a figure of $52,500 in full and final settlement of the matter. This figure has been transparently provided to local media and publicly reported and clearly articulated by you in a previous public question time session on the 5th of June.
I asked for what the MAV costs were.
Sorry, is this your...
It was a very specific question. The MAV costs were awarded by Council...
I'll take this as your second question then.
Are we going to get the MAV costs in the audited accounts for last year?
Neither...
What may be in the audited accounts?
They will be...
Could I ask the CEO that question?
Of course.
I don't actually understand the question. However, I don't.
It should be the CEO.
Well, that might be the case.
If you interject one more time, I'll have to ask you to leave.
Because we paid a sum of money to the Municipal Association, of course, the amount we paid is part of our financial operations for the year ending June 30, 2017. That would go without saying. Whether the statement of accounts don't record, of course they don't record every debtor paid for the year. That would require...
That's unusual, isn't it?
That's...
Mr. Sanigan, I gave you a warning.
Completely normal. We don't make a record of every debtor. I'm not sure the questioner understands the scope of what he's talking about in the slightest. We probably have something like 20,000 debtors that would be paid during the year. So,
but you know what it is.
So I'm sorry, I'm going to have to ask you to leave now. You interjected again and again, and I've warned you twice. I've warned you. You are allowed two questions. You have now asked the two questions. When you interjected the first time, I said, is this your second question? And you continued.
Now listen, I'm not going to be disciplined by you. I'm not going to be disciplined by anyone. Have you got anyone that can throw me out?
Yep. Okay, I'd like to adjourn the meeting for 5 minutes while we call the police so that you may be removed.
Call the police as I live and breathe. Do we live in a democracy or not? Do we live in a democracy? You're going to call the police on me. I'll save you the trouble, Councillor, and I will leave. Just a moment. Just a moment. I will save you the trouble by leaving. But I want it to be on the record, not only the answer to my question, that you were prepared to call the police to have me ejected from this forum. Highly irregular, highly unusual, and completely, to me, unacceptable. But I will leave. But I'll be back.
We might just have a couple of minutes break just so we can cool down.
The way you move is that you move it, you know, you move the resolution with your changes.
Working? Can you hear me, everybody? Yes, good. The next question is from Anne Labor. Hello. Yes. You have to talk into the microphone. Sorry. Just so that people watching live can hear you.
Mayor, I'd like to commend the Darebin Council for implementing a new parking permit policy. However, I do wish to ask how, as more and more developments are going to be post-2004, you know, being built after that period, how are those residents going to be parked, especially with the wave of parking? And so I want to know whether the council have a long-term plan for these residents. I'm lucky I'm not in that position, so this is not a personal issue for me. I'm speaking on behalf of all ratepayers who have a problem with it if their place is built after 2004. So do you have some answer to that at all?
If I may, just in relation to this point, if I may, I just want to flag that when we get to that item, I'll be moving that we defer that item. And there are a few issues associated with that that we need further information, and one is obviously...
Thank you, Councillor Greco. Just, I guess, a clarification to your question, that this policy is not a new policy, it's an existing policy, but it's the first time it's being put to this chamber for being adopted. It was previously a policy that was operational and that was approved by the CEO. So the one that's before us tonight, the proposed parking permit policy forces developers to think about how they are going to sell a property without the ability for the future resident to park on the street. So similarly, it forces potential purchasers to consider if the number of parking spaces associated with the dwelling that they're purchasing is sufficient to cater for their needs. More importantly, the current policy allows us to protect the existing amenity of residents from that development. And I note that the proposed policy simply formalises what the current approach to residential parking permits, how it's been operating over the last few years.
I misunderstood it, because I thought with the current parking policy, if you had a garage or a driveway, you weren't entitled to a parking permit.
I don't have the former policy in front of me, but it's my understanding... We can probably get you the old arrangement for you to compare.
Yeah, that's what I thought that I heard from Nathan.
Okay. In regards to the second part of your question, in regards to the long-term plan for parking, Council will be engaging with the community in the coming months with the intention of understanding the issues, the opportunities and what actions are required to manage car parking going into the future and, as you described, the ongoing development. So this engagement will lead to a comprehensive car parking strategy for the municipality.
Thank you. My second question is it's not an attack on the council, it's just a question, because I've had some information from Ratepayers Victoria concerning MAV, and they're concerned about the costs of the MAV. They receive substantial funding from the state government, and Ratepayers Victoria are concerned that all councils are not getting value for money, and that the MAV are outdated in the practices and procedures. And so I'm just concerned that you're not getting value for money from the 87,000 subscription.
So council's membership with the MAV is listed on tonight's agenda for noting, and the council will determine whether to continue with its membership or not. Just an aside, on the 1st of May 2017, council resolved to appoint a new general insurance broker who is not with the MAV. No longer utilising MAV's insurance services.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from Serena O'Mealy. I'll read out the question. Darabin Council resolved on the 16th of May 2016 to enter into a 10-year lease arrangement with the Australian Skate Company with the intention to redevelop the Sullivan Stadium indoor skate rink to an indoor ice rink. The motion also said that Council must receive a yearly report on the performance and operations of the pavilion. As far as I can see, there hasn't been a report to Council in the past year, and the Mayor please provide a progress report on the redevelopment. So this item is listed to be considered by Council at our meeting on the 21st of August 2017. Due to the plan redevelopment works, this facility is currently closed, therefore reporting on the performance and the operations of the facility is unavailable until the redevelopment is complete, which is being undertaken by the lessee. Are there any other questions? No? Thank you, everybody. We'll move on to item 6, consideration of reports. 6.1, progress report, windows and gutter cleaning reimbursement subsidy program. Thank you. Moved by Councillor Messina and seconded by Councillor Greco. Councillor Messina, would you like to talk to the motion?
I think we have an amendment to that motion, do we not?
There's been no proposed amendment so far. You'd like to move an alternative motion to what's been listed in the agenda?
I think we've submitted some amendments, some changes to the recommendation, which will be the motion. And hopefully they'll come up, and then we can actually talk to those to those changes.
I haven't been on email this afternoon, so I've probably missed that traffic. Councillor Messina, that your intention was to move that motion that's on the screen?
Yeah, with an addition.
With Gaetano's.
Yeah, that is Gaetano, but I was going to actually make an addition to change to that. And that is that number 3 promotes a service in the Darabin Community News and Darabin social media platforms.
Okay, just to be clear, you're moving that motion?
Yep.
As it is. Okay, Councillor Greco, and you'll second?
Yep.
Councillor Messina, would you like to now speak to that one?
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm happy to support this motion with the amendment. The window and gutter cleaning services indoor subsidy model of 50% where the consumer engages a contractor of their choice with council reimbursement to the consumer. The level of the subsidy is based on a maximum reimbursement of $120 per hour for each service. With the implementation of the new aged care reforms and the transitions to home care community packages, the consumer will have a platform of choices. Today, I sought further clarity about the accessibility by older residents who require support for window and gutter and cleaning. What if these residents were not currently receiving aged care services through Darabin Community, through Darabin City Council? Would they still be eligible? And I'm happy to say that yes, they will still be eligible to receive the funding. May I take this opportunity to share a story with you about a long-time resident of Darabin. Many decades ago, at the young age of 16, I boarded a vessel bound for Australia. My parents wanted me to join my married older sister there to secure a better future for myself. I settled in St. George's Road, Northcote, where I lived and worked as a seamstress with my sister's family. I married and then moved to Peel Park. I'm 89 years of age today. I have three amazing children and five special grandchildren. My husband and I worked long hours to save and support our family. We educated our children, watched them marry and establish themselves. This home I live in today is my asset. It's the only tangible asset I have. My husband passed away 20 years ago. Today I sit seated in the back of my home, blanket wrapped around me. It's cold, but tonight is the day my daughter and her family come to visit me. I have coffee in the cafeteria on the stove waiting. I asked the carer who attended to my personal care today to wind the cafeteria tightly for me. My mobility is poor. I use my wheelchair to ambulate around my home. I don't have the strength that I used to have. The huge window I wait by is dirty. I see spider webs, dirty marks. The spouting is full of leaves, and occasionally after the rain, the water overflows from the scuttering onto my veranda. They may not represent anything to anybody, but it's not cultural or historically what I'm accustomed to. I recall back in my time when I was teaching my 10-year-old to clean that window with vinegar and cloth. I'm incapable of cleaning my window. My hands and my fingers are threaded. My arm span is limited. I'm grateful for the opportunity to come to Australia. My husband and I worked for many years and paid our taxes. I thank the council for considering this motion, and it gives me the opportunity to sit by my window and see it clean. Our generation worked to support themselves. We made time. This generation is fast-paced and they don't have the time. I don't ask my family to clean my windows. Why? Because I'm used to be able to. I don't ask my family to fix my spouting. Why? They like you a time poor. Signed, Signora Maria. I'm proudly providing consumers with choice. This will provide consumers with choice. It is a positive move forward. I wait for the
Thank you, Councillor
Messina.
Councillor Greco.
Thank you, Matt. I'd like to thank Councillor Messina for that wonderful story from a resident. Look, just in relation to this, just to give very briefly some history in relation to this, this scheme in terms of clean gutters and clean windows was defunded by the federal government. And what happened is that council actually asked our officers through a resolution that was passed at the council is to come back to council with options and with a proposal how we can keep this service going. And then unfortunately the officers came back with a model that enabled council to, at no extra cost in a sense, because we were already committing money to this particular service, to come back with a scheme that enabled us to carry on the service. And as Councillor Messina said through that wonderful story, is that residents, particularly Alberton residents, look towards the council as an organisation that provides services that they can trust. And as a result of this is why that we've been able to promote this service. Also, what's important to note is that when we put the service into place, it was. It's been now nearly 12 months, and there's been quite a good uptake of the service, and it sort of shows that if the council puts its head together in relation to continuing to provide services and not opting out of providing services to particularly our most vulnerable and our aged community, that there will be a reception out there, and there is a clear reception out there for our particular services. In terms of the last point, and I'm glad that Councillor Messina has actually complimented it, is that from reading the report, I feel that we haven't done enough work in promoting the service, particularly amongst our ageing community, and particularly amongst the community that's from different ethnic backgrounds. So what I'm suggesting there is that we get out there, we tell people about the service, and also because it's been my experience that in that period when the service was actually suspended as a result of not receiving federal government funding, so there's a bit of confusion out there in the community whether council still provides this service or does not provide the service. And I think from what I can gather, and people often ask me, is whether council is still in the game of cleaning windows and also cleaning people's gutters. And I think we need to get out there to promote it, to make it clear to people that the council is still in that business, and that we can get the message to as many people as possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Greco. Are there any other speakers?
I would note one thing. This is actually a very specific service. It's not available to everyone, as the report outlines.
Yep.
But one of the benefits of communicating about it more broadly is actually for the broader community to be aware of the fact that the service is available, so that if they have a relative who may be eligible, they can refer them. And so I think we need to see the value of that broader communication, that sometimes people aren't aware of what services are available, and hence speaking and engaging with children, family, friends and neighbours can sometimes broaden that reach. So just in relation to that question, it is a very specific service, but it's a service which hopefully more data and people should be aware of.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Any other speakers? If not, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Item 6.2, Darabin Kindergarten Centralised Waiting List. As I disclosed earlier, I have a conflict of interest with this item. The type of interest is that is an indirect interest, as I am an interested party, as my son is currently on that waiting list. So I will leave the room for the entirety of the time.
Before the Mayor leaves, I'll just declare the same interest. I have an interested party and therefore an indirect interest, I believe also by close association as a family member is involved, as I have a son who is on the kindergarten waiting list. So I'll also be leaving the chamber.
And I'll ask Councillor Griffin to take the picture.
Okay, councillors, we're dealing with item 6.2, Darabin Kindergarten Centralised Waiting List. But before I proceed, councillors, just just to clarify, I had moved an amendment as a councillor, an alternative motion as a councillor in relation to this particular item. And I've since spoken to Councillor Williams, who will be moving the item and also speaking to it. So just as just stated that as in order to clarify the proceedings. So, Councillor Williams, will you be moving?
Yep, happy to move.
Okay, we'll have it up there on the screen. I'll give councillors, this was circulated earlier today, I'll give councillors a minute just to refresh their memory about it, particularly the red section there that adds to the officer recommendation, and then ask for a seconder.
I'd like to second with an addition.
Okay, can we hear the addition, Councillor?
So this would become point six, I'll read it out and provide context. The kindergarten applications be part of Darabin's digital transformation project, including a simplified application process to improve accessibility for families and tracking of their position on the wait list for their preferred kindergarten.
Thank you. Can we give that to the officers, and hopefully in the meantime they could perhaps type it up so we could see it up there on the screen. So Councillor Williams, would you agree with what's being read out? Okay, that's fine. So Councillor, would you like to speak to the motion?
Well, obviously early years of kindergarten is a huge part of children growing up in Darabin, and in doing further investigation and trying to get as many people on board in coming to attend to kindergartens, it's important that we really get that gap, especially those who are vulnerable in their community. So I believe that my fellow councillor has already put in an amendment to have a further report to see if we can get the statistics and those measurements to the compare, that we can come back and see where those gaps are so we can further do more advancement in this particular area.
Thank you, Councillor Neal.
Certainly seconding the comments made by Councillor Williams. Kindergarten's really important, and I'm really proud that this policy supports vulnerable families to make sure they have priority access for kindergarten. It is a very challenging issue, and certainly one that as a councillor we get concern from parents about making sure that the system is as fair as possible with lots of different things to balance. I included this amendment around including the application process as part of the digital transformation project because the current application process is very difficult and cumbersome, and I'm concerned that it makes the process inaccessible for some of these vulnerable families that we're trying to make sure their children are involved in kindergarten. My understanding is that it's already within the scope of digital transformation project, but I hope that by raising it here, we can make sure that it's a priority and includes the components mentioned here of the simplified process, not just moving the current process online, and also having more transparent information about people's position on the wait list. My understanding is that a lot of the stress associated with the wait list is not just that people may or may not get onto get their child into the kindergarten of their choice, perhaps the one that's closest or that where their children's friends are at, but also not knowing whether or not this will be the case, and having more information will enable parents to be able to plan for the future, which may involve staying within the council programs or perhaps looking at other alternatives for their children.
Thank you, Councillor Mayor. Are there any further speakers in relation to this item? Councillor Yuzu?
Thank you, Councillor Crawford. Just briefly, I want to commend steps to ensure that our vulnerable families get access to kindergarten, and I second Councillor Mayor's amendment to simplify the process. We know this has been a media issue recently, and I know this is a bit bigger than the initial scope of the report, but I think it's really important to make the process as simple and easy as possible for all families.
Thank you, Councillor. Any further speakers in relation to this item? If there's no further speakers, I'll put the motion as it appears there on the screen. Those in favour? Okay, carried unanimously. Thank you, Councillor. We're calling the Mayor and Councillor Picanto.
Before we go on, I just wanted to clarify in terms of my indirect interest is also by close association, just to make sure that it's recorded appropriately in the minutes of the previous item. Moving on to item 6.3, digital transformation strategy.
Can I move?
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy, and second to Councillor Rennie. Councillor McCarthy, would you like to speak to the motion?
Yes, so I'll keep it brief. Firstly, I'm really pleased that this has come to us because it is timely, not only because we have just adopted the council plan, which makes a very strong commitment to council being more agile and efficient and nimble in terms of how it runs its operations and how it responds to the community, but also, wherever possible, how it is more open and transparent and available to the community at all the different times in life when our community needs access to council services. Stepping back away from this for a moment, it was only a year or two that we actually put planning applications and the information about planning applications online. Previously, you had to be available and come in between Monday and Friday, 9 to 5. They're now available online. It's not always a perfect system, but it means that people who work full-time have the same access to information that they need in order to make an objection and engage with the planning process. What we have here is an action which is listed in the council plan just adopted. It's the digital transformation strategy. It's a significant investment by council. It has been foreshadowed and budgeted, and in the upcoming, in the current financial year now, in fact, that we're now in, council's committed $590,000 to this project out of a total project over the next few years of around $2.6 million. That is a lot of money. It is a significant investment from council and from ratepayers. But the whole idea here is that by virtue of spending money in terms of becoming more efficient in terms of our use of digital technology for our operations, we're actually going to be saving people a lot more money over time. And that's really one of the key things that needs to be highlighted with this. Part of the problem with running a complex organisation with over 100 services is that systems don't always talk to each other, which means that at the same time as you could be paying your rates, you can't necessarily be dealing with another transaction that you have with council. And we want to make things as easy as possible for our community to engage with council on every front, and as many services as possible to be brought online so that people can access them after hours, in their own time, and of course in multiple languages. And this is also about pushing past the barriers that exist sometimes in terms of cultural and linguistic barriers that exist with council services. We do pretty well most of the time, but we can always do better. Part of what we're also doing here is looking at how we can make processes more efficient. So instead of asking people to fill out multiple forms, submit them, hand them in, post them, which delays people getting action on a particular matter, whether it's a permit for a cattle dog through to a statutory planning application, but as much of that possible is made available online and is simple, effective and smart, and in fact makes it as easy as possible for people to get decisions made quickly. So I'm fully supportive of what we're doing here. I think that the hard work is going to be officers having to adjust to different systems, but this is a process of cultural change and it's very timely and it has my full support.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Rennie.
I'm also very much in support of the direction that we're taking here. We can't even begin to imagine, I think, where we might be in terms of the technology that might support council services and activities 10 years from now. If we don't move, we'll be left behind and we simply won't be able to deliver the sort of customer experience and the community services that our community expects. So I think the aims of this strategy are very sound. It's about providing a customer with outstanding experience, empowering the organisation to deliver seamless customer experience, providing a technology environment that is stable, secure and flexible, enabling the organisation to deliver services to the community anywhere and anytime, and future-proofing Darabin's technology blends and related services. This is not work that's optional, this is simply work that we have to do, and I think that's important. It is a very significant investment. We might think, oh, wouldn't we rather have parks? The reality is, in the future, we won't be able to have anything if we don't have the technological platform that supports it. From a point of view of the work that we all do and the experience our community has with council, it could be vastly improved. If someone could ring up or log on, give their rates notice or their address, and have everything else populated for them so people knew exactly what services they used, what contacts they had with council, that they could see all of that online, they knew where their queries were, they didn't have to repopulate a form, fill out more details. Not only would it save council money, it would save our community money, and in fact, the sort of savings that we get as a community translate into real and meaningful benefits for our community in terms of their health and wellbeing and connectedness to council and the services we deliver. So on that basis, I fully support this, and I look forward to the investment that we're making because it's an investment in the future for all of us.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Are there any other speakers? Councillor Greco.
Thank you, Madam. I'll speak in favour of this, but also I have a slight amendment and an additional
We'll just bring them up on screen and see if they're acceptable to the mover and seconder.
It's quite self-explanatory.
Just before we go on, we'll just let people read it and see if it's accepted.
Yep.
Councillor
McCarthy?
Look, I'm happy to accept it. It makes it explicit. I think it's inherent in the report about cold communication.
Thank you. Yes.
So I'm happy to accept it, for it makes it explicit.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Greco, would you like to now speak to the motion?
Yeah, thank you, Councillor McCarthy, and thank you, councillors. Look, I won't go over the points that the other councillors have spoken about, just to say that it's really exciting that that this digital strategy has come to council, and it really puts us into the 21st century. And I must say also that it's well overdue, and not only our councils, many other councils have been digitally challenged, to say the least. Look, the fifth point that I put there is that I really want to focus in on the digital interface that the community will have with council. And whilst the report does talk about, and the strategy does talk about that, I don't think it talks about it in depth in terms of how it actually impacts on people whose digital literacy is low, or in relation to harnessing the opportunity that new technology can provide us in relation to enabling, giving us greater opportunity in respect to people whose first language is not English, and making it also a seamless interface with council using new technology. We know this already exists if you look at the internet or the various applications and programs that are out there that actually translate material very quickly, and people are able to get understandings of various services and various activities via internet. We need to apply that to a council setting. And that's why I've called for a further report, because we need to do a little bit more work in relation to how we can assist people whose literacy levels are low in relation to new technology, and how we can harness the opportunities that technology gives us to make it a seamless operation for people whose first language is not English.
Thank you, Councillor Gregory. Councillor Williams.
Over the last 5 years that I've been on council, it's probably one of the biggest complaints that we've had from our community. We have over 150 languages spoken here in Darabin, and many people work and at different hours they're unable to come to council, and as previously Councillor McCarthy has mentioned, to get printouts of what planning applications available. So this is probably the first time that we've injected so much money in our technology. We'll be injecting another 350 in the 2018-2019. Now I think it's a great idea because technology is changing on a daily basis, and we need to keep up with our modern world. It's important that not only that we're giving our community that flexibility so they can get online at any time, but it's also, we will hopefully, the other biggest frustration that we've had in complaints is that it hasn't been very user-friendly, like being a can of worms. So I'm hoping that the new system and the new platform will be a lot more user-friendly, and that residents and the community will be able to get online and be able to navigate our new system in the future.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. Are there any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That's carried. Thank you. Item 6.4, Residential Parking Permit Policy 2017.
I'm going to move a motion that we defer this particular report for 2 weeks, and the reason for the deferral is to get further information in relation to the policy. There's a lot of information already in this report, but I don't think it's rigorous enough. I think we need further information.
Before
and,
you get into debating the deferral, thank you. Is there a seconder for that deferral? Councillor McCarthy, second. Councillor Greco, would you like to now speak to the motion to defer?
Just very simply, look, the report has a lot of information there, and it gives a basic structure of what the parking permit policy ought to be going forward. But I feel that I have some reservations about certain questions that have been raised here in this policy. And that before moving a motion in relation to changing the policy, I'd like to get some further information in regards to some of the issues that I have, and I'm sure other councillors would have a few questions in regards to the policy. And on the basis of that, I'm asking that we defer it, maybe just for 2 weeks, so we can get that information to complement what's already in here, so we can make a much more informed decision. Or if need be, if we need to change any of the aspects of the policy, we could do that in a much more informed manner.
Thank you, Councillor Greco. Councillor McCarthy, would you like to speak to the motion?
Thank you. Look, I do second a deferral, not because I necessarily have any immediate concerns with the policy, which is actually a formalisation of the practice that is already in place, but because on page 25 and 26, as councillors would see, the author of the report is very clear to say that it is not recommended to make any changes. So when we talk about options for consideration in relation to a report like this and a policy, it is not a case of saying change it here or change it there. So I would be concerned if we were actually considering amendments on the hop this evening in relation to this policy without them actually being fully considered and thought through. I'm supportive of the best possible process. I think I would say, and it's just out of fairness to our officers, that we do really need to engage with these reports as early as possible and make sure that we have those questions circulated so that officers have the chance to respond. So we can deal with these in the moment rather than on the run. So on that basis, I'm happy to support deferral, but I do so in the hope that we deal with this at the next meeting and keep it moving.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Are there any further speakers?
Madam Mayor, would you just permit me? I don't think it's workable at the next meeting, given that that agenda's circulated, completed bureaucratically by about Thursday. So I think, given that this is a standard policy which has been in practice for however many years, an August council meeting would be fine.
Thank you. I'll now put that motion to defer. Are we
formal open to the reorder?
I think
it's
in relationship
when available, I guess.
When next practical, maybe?
Yeah, next practical.
Is everybody, Councillor McCarthy, are you happy with that?
Yeah.
Okay. All those in favour? Carried.
Item 6.5, Municipal Association of Victoria Membership Subscription 2017-18.
Does anyone have any motion? Councillor Rennings.
I'm happy to move the recommendation.
Thank you. And Councillor McCarthy second. Councillor Rennie, would you like to speak to the motion?
Thank you. This is a motion that simply notes that we note the attached summary provided by the MAB highlighting their performance for the past financial year, as well as the overview of membership benefits. I think we're all aware that some questions have obviously been raised tonight, and that, you know, it is a discussion about what value and benefit we get out of membership of the MAB, and indeed membership of any body that we choose to join. And I think it's incumbent upon us to actually think of what we put in, because to some extent you get out of something what you put in, and I think that this is a council that has sought to engage perhaps more actively in the MAB and the MAB activities than previous councils. I think we need to see what comes of our participation over the next year in the MAB. I note that I am the MAB rep and participated actively at State Council, and in fact received support at State Council for the two motions that Darren and Council put forward, one which was on the landfill levy and the other
climate emergency.
Thank you. And look, it was great to be able to put forward those motions that have been supported by delegates. I'm also on three of their subcommittees, Human Services, Transport and Infrastructure and Planning. I note that the Mayor, Councillor Serg, is also on the Environment Working Group. I think this is an opportunity for us to actually see how these groups are working, what we can contribute and what we can bring back to Council, and I think that's a very important process that will actually contribute to our understanding of the value that we're getting out of MAB membership and in fact the value that they contribute to the sector.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Councillor McCarthy?
Look, I support this. I'm the proxy MAB rep, so I haven't been had to step into that role this year, but happy to do so if required. The MAB is actually a really interesting organisation because it is historically is the peak body, and yet we actually have multiple peak bodies in local government these days and different forms of engagement with them. I think the one thing that I would note, and I think it's evidenced by the resolutions supported at the MAV State Council that put forward by Councillor Reddy, is the MAV up to the task that we have asked it to perform in relation to taking the message of the climate emergency and actually delivering that through 79 local councils and to the state government? And for me, this is a really interesting test. When a motion is passed to the MAV State Council, what does it mean? Does the MAV then take that seriously? Does it take the will of the membership seriously in that regard? We have written, of course, and I think we are encouraging other councils to take action, but if the peak body, whose own state council, adopts such a resolution, which did occur, do they then follow through? And so I would signal a real desire from this council to see the MAV follow through on that issue. It has followed through on some other issues, thankfully, and we have asked in our submission to the MAV review of its legislation for the MAV to have a different approach to what it has in relation to some of these issues. It is highly dependent upon state government funding for a number of its projects, but that shouldn't prevent it from taking the fight up to the state government in a more vociferous way on some key issues. And one of those is the expenditure of the waste levy, the landfill levy, which of course we know in this chamber has been mishandled on many fronts and underspent when it should in fact be invested in communities. So this is a real test for the MAB, but I'm prepared to give them another year and see how they go.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? Councillor Greco?
Yeah, look, I'm prepared to support this this motion and for us to continue to be members of the MAB. Look, the MAB is the umbrella organisation. It's the peak body for the local governments in Victoria. And I used to be an MAV rep for council, and also I served 2 years on the MAV board. And the MAV has been effective in the past. Just one example that comes to mind is the strong campaign that they ran in relation to saving our libraries when our libraries were under threat by by budget cuts, by state government budget cuts. The NAB organised councils and were able to defend the status of our libraries and also the money that comes to our libraries. I think councils are in a state of change. Even tonight we were talking about improving our digital services on council and having actually very much a forward 21st century vision for councils. I think the NAB is also in a state of change in terms of it has to deal with 79 councils, and various councils are all at different levels. And I think that the NAB also is undergoing a process of change in terms of ensuring that change is filtered through down into individual organisations that are affiliated to the NAB. So I think we really need to work closely with the NAB because there will be a lot of challenges out there in the future, and that we need to have one big strong voice, which I think that can be carried by the NAB, to ensure that local government continues to have a strong role in our community.
Thank you, Councillor Greco. Are there any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Item 6.6, delegation of powers, duties and functions to the Chief Executive Officer. Thank you, Councillor McCarthy, mover. Is there a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Councillor McCarthy, would you like to speak?
Look, I don't have a great deal to add to this. It's pretty self-explanatory. It is a standard motion that we must move in the Chamber on an annual basis, which is to confer to our Chief Executive a number of the powers that are rested in this Chamber as the Council when we meet in relation to a whole lot of functions of the organisation. Were we not to delegate those powers and responsibilities to the Chief Executive Officer, we'd have meetings that would go for days, not for hours. And I don't think that's fair on the public or our officers. So it is the right thing to do. It is a simple thing to do. It's an important thing to do, and it's clearly laid out, and therefore it's a transparent thing to do as well.
Thank you. Councillor Rennie?
Nothing to add.
I ask at this point if there's anyone who wants to speak in opposition, otherwise I'll put it to the vote. No? All those in favour? Motion is carried. Item 6.7, delegations of power duties, functions to council staff. Thank you, Councillor McCarthy, and a seconder. Thank you, Councillor Amir. Councillor McCarthy.
The exact same speech, but with council staff replacing the Chief Executive Officer.
Thank you, Councillor Amir.
The exact same response, replacing Councillor Rennie with Councillor Amir.
Thank you. Put that to the vote. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Item 7, consideration of responses to petitions, notices of motion and general business.
Sorry, it's only 6.8.
Item 6.8, appointment of an external audit committee member. Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Move and a seconder. Thank you, Councillor Amir. Councillor Rennie.
This is a fairly straightforward, in some ways procedural matter, which is that the Audit and Risk Committee should have 3 external auditors. We currently have 2 external auditors. There was an open and transparent recruitment process, and a number of applications were received. The Mayor and myself looked through those applications and determined that Ms. Janine Bush was the most suitable and qualified applicant. I really commend her to all of you as the 3rd member of the Audit and Risk Committee. I think she's got some exceptional skills that committee could benefit from. Notably, not only has she got a lot of experience in the audit area, but has quite significant other experience as a senior executive, including having been a CEO, and a diversity of experience that I think will actually be very valuable indeed on our Audit and Risk Committee. I think that we recognise that risk is not just about financial risk, it's not just about accounting. There's a whole lot of ways in which we need to understand and get our minds across risk in an organisation of this size, and that we actually need, in order to do that, a committee that is drawn from diverse areas with a diverse range of skills. And I think that Ms. Janine Bush will actually add to our committee something quite significant, and I commend her appointment to all of you.
Thank you, Councillor Amin.
The audit committee is certainly very important and something we definitely want to get right. And as was mentioned by Councillor Rennie, Janine Bush is very experienced. I've worked with her previously in a previous role and I'm very pleased to endorse it.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Now we'll move on to item 27, consideration of responses to petitions, notices of motion and general business. There is none. Item 8, notices of motion, 8.1, raising a West Papuan flag on the 1st of December 2017. Councillor Newton?
I'd like to move the motion.
Thank you. As listed in the agenda?
Yes. As listed in the
agenda. Is there a second for that motion? Thank you, Councillor Newton. Councillor Newton?
Thank you, Martha. Today I attended two flag raising ceremonies for NAIDOC Week that brought our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander community and wider community together to celebrate history, culture and achievements of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander communities. We proudly have a rainbow flag flying outside the Preston Town Hall until marriage equality is reached. The symbolism of the large Aboriginal flag flying over Bell City and the rainbow flag over Preston Town Hall is powerful. I'd like us to raise the West Papuan Morning Star flag on Friday the 1st of December this year in solidarity with our West Papuan community here in Darabin and the West Papuan community more generally, as well as holding an event with the West Papuan community and the Ethnic Communities Council for awareness raising and community building. West Papua is considered a province of Indonesia that is historically and culturally largely Melanesian. It was first colonised by the Netherlands, as were the islands that now make up Indonesia. When Indonesia became independent in 1949, West Papua did not join the country. It was expected that West Papua would become independent, and West Papua held a congress in 1961, at which its people declared independence and raised their new flag on the 1st of December that year, the Morning Star. However, Indonesia invaded the country later that year. Conflict broke out over control of the territory, and in 1962, control of West Papua was given to the UN, and 1 year later to Indonesia. The Papuans were not consulted. With agreement to promise them the right to self-determination, a right guaranteed to all people in the world. While it was agreed by 1969, the UN should oversee plebiscite of the people of Papua and West Papua, in which they were given two choices, remain part of Indonesia or become an independent nation. This vote was referred to as an act of free choice, but the vote was actually conducted by consensus decision-making, with consensus of elders numbering 1,000 out of a population of 1 million that was selected by the Indonesian military and were coerced into voting unanimously to remain part of Indonesia. The result of the compromise vote was rejected by Papua nationalists who established the Free Papua Movement. The independence movement has continued until today. Councillor Mira and I have recently met with Papuans who are Darwin residents, including Jeffrey Dequa, who sought refuge in Australia as a teenager in search of a safer life. In solidarity with Jeffrey, Gillian and other Darwin West Papua residents who supported the self-determination of people of Papua, I wish to raise the West Papua flag on the 1st of December. In 2016, the flag was raised at Kyneton Town Hall, the Castle Main Council Building, and Trades Hall, Melbourne and Ballarat. There are precincts for flying community flags such as Yarra Council, where they fly the Ko Bang, Old South Vietnamese flag, the West Sahara flag, and the Cyprus flag on special days. I thank Rebecca Langley, Jeffrey Yequa, and Gillian for bringing this to our attention.
Thank you, Councillor Newton. Councillor Mayne?
Before I speak, I was wondering, as a procedural query, whether there might be members of the gallery who might wish to make a statement on this issue.
There was no one that was registered to submit on this issue, but perhaps... if it's okay with leave of the council, we will hear them speak. Yes?
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
Do you want to grab the microphone, somebody? Oh. Do you wish to speak? No. Okay. Councillor Mee, would you like to speak as a seconder of the motion?
Yes. So this is... something that's come from residents here in Darabin from the West Papuan community who are seeking our support in the raising of the flag. Certainly, you know, while this is not an issue without different perspectives, I think here in Darabin we support the right people to live in freedom, and this is what it represents to the people of West Papua and hopefully to us here in Darabin as well. And so I think it's something that's worth us considering here tonight.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? No? If not, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Item... there are no other notices of motion. So item 9 is urgent business, and there is an item of urgent business that the CEO wishes to place on the agenda. So we will put it up on the screen and we will have to accept it onto the agenda. I'll give you a moment to read. Thank you.
to move the motion? Oh, yes, I'll put it on the agenda, yes.
Be happy to move the motion to put it onto the agenda. Thank you, Councillor Muir. Is there a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Rennie. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Is there a mover of that motion?
I'm happy to move the motion with the amendment of adding an apostrophe at tonight's council meeting.
Councillor Rennie, I'm sure that you're happy to accept that grammar change.
Yes. I'd actually...
Oh, hang on, sorry, no, you didn't second that. That's you moving the motion, and we need a seconder. Councillor Rennie, would you second with a proposed change?
With a proposed change,
yeah. What's your change?
The change would be that we're seeking legal intervention, seeking to forbid Mr. Sanninger's attendance at council meetings for the remainder of this four-year term of council. I think there's some ambiguity in the indefinitely and until.
Yeah. Councillor Muir, do you accept that?
Yep.
Okay, Councillor Muir, would you like to speak to the motion?
So Mr. Sanninger has attended many council meetings, coming to every council meeting in recent months. My view is that he attends the meetings with the intention of trying to bring the council into disrepute, and that's not the role of the public question time that we have here. He's very aggressive, he's been openly sexist, openly homophobic. The way he's treated the mayor has been horrendous, and I think that without his presence, council meetings will be of a tone that is more the kind of tone that we'd want here in Darebin.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie.
I believe that this is appropriate, albeit somewhat extraordinary. I think in defence of this, Mr. Sanninger's behaviour has been extraordinary. It's been extraordinarily bad, and it would appear to me that his attendance at council serves primarily his desire to harass and intimidate councillors. I note that he's taken that unacceptable behaviour outside of council to a point where he has harassed and intimidated and threatened councillors in their own homes or at their own homes and in public locations. That behaviour is simply unacceptable. As much as we seek to be an open forum where every member of our community can come and participate and ask questions, that has allowed, I think, and we have been generous in allowing Mr. Sanninger a huge amount of leeway in actually coming with questions. But I see them serving no good purpose, and note that he could actually submit any number of questions online and have responses provided to him in that way. This motion, I actually think, offers him a choice and an ability to moderate his behaviour if he chooses to do so. And if he doesn't, I don't think that further opportunities are appropriate. I think that if he continues to demonstrate similar behaviour, then seeking an intervention or a full term of this council is appropriate.
Thank you, Councillor. Are there any further speakers? Councillor Newman.
I support this motion. We've been in this council chamber for 7 months with Warren Sanninger coming here every meeting to abuse the mayor and different councillors constantly. I don't think with any productive intent. I think only with the intent to harass and abuse councillors. So I completely support this motion. I think it's. I think that he's been given a handful of chances.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Are there any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Is there any other urgent business items? No. Item 10 is general business. There is none. Item 11, petitions. Are there any petitions? No petitions. Item 12, reports of standing committees. There is none. Item 13, records of assemblies of councillors. 13.1, assemblies of councillors held. Thank you. Moved by Councillor Messina, seconded by Councillor McCarthy. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Item 14, reports by Mayor and councillors. They are sitting on the desk here. I'd just like to... the meeting with Minus 18 is... I think it's reported against me, and I did not attend that meeting today, so that could be eliminated from my report. Other than that, Councillor McCarthy would like to move. And is there a seconder? Thank you, Councillor Messina. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Item 15, consideration of reports,
considered confidential. So, item 15.1, installation of a portable class room building at the Mary Lands Community Centre. So this item is deemed confidential due to a contractual matter, and so would someone like to move a motion to go in to
move motion to meeting?
Thank you, Councillor Rennie, and seconding Councillor Messina. All those in favour? Motion is carried. Thank you to the members of the public who are still in the gallery. This meeting is now being closed to consider a confidential matter. You will be invited to join us in the function room, which is behind us shortly.